The Tears of the Sun, A Novel of the Change, by S.M. Stirling. Narrated by Todd McLaren. Copyright 2011 by Stephen M. Stirling. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with S.M. Stirling and Scoville Galen Ghosh Literary Agency, Incorporated, and was produced in the year 2011 by Tantor Media, Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Chapter 1. Dun Juniper, Dutkas of the Clan Mackenzie, formerly the East Central Willamette Valley, Oregon, High Kingdom of Montabal, formerly Western North America, July 31st, change year 25, 2023 AD. Rudy Mackenzie, Artos the First, High King of Montabal, though yet to be formally crowned, finished the last crusty bite of the ham sandwich, savoring the smoky taste of the cured meat and sharp cheese, and washed it down with a last swallow in the clay crock of beer. Then he leaned back against the smooth, worn roots of the gnarled wild apple tree and sighed, listening to the soft sough of wind and branches, the hum of bees. A sharp tup-tup came from a flock of little yellow-faced warblers diving through a cloud of mayflies, and then a buzzing zee-zee-zee-zee as they swarmed off like swooping dots of sunlight into the Douglas firs above. "Now this," he said, "is something on the order of a homecoming, so it is. Or close enough for government work until the war is over. Which is appropriate, since now we are the government." His newly hand-fasted bride, Matilda Arminger, snuggled into the curve of his shoulder, a pleasant, solid burden, her brown hair smelling of summer like the sun-warmed grass in which they rested, and her strong, not quite pretty features relaxed as she turned her face towards the sun. The weight didn't bother him, though Matilda was a rangy 5'9" and had the leanly, solid build of someone who'd trained to fight in armor most of her life. He was a tall man, born late in the first year of the change, which made him a few months older than his bride. Long-limbed, broad in the shoulders and narrow in the waist, with a regular high-cheeked face just on the edge of beauty, a shoulder-length mane of hair a color halfway between gold and molten copper, and light eyes of a changeable blue-green-gray.
"It's far beyond barren, this is. We've seen everything from the sunset ocean to the lands of sunrise, and nothing can quite compare," he said softly.
He pulled a strand of long grass free and chewed meditatively on the stem as they looked down through the screen of firs to the open benchland below. That made an irregular oval of grassland running east-west along the side of the hill, about a mile long and half a mile wide at its broadest. Most of it was rolling meadowland, where horses and red-coated cattle grazed thick green grass, starred with pink lupin and white daisies, separated by hawthorn hedge and weathered board fence into paddocks studded with great gary oaks, or the tall black walnuts his mother's great-uncle had planted long before the change. Beyond that, the forested ground fell away steeply and blocked sight of the little valley of Artemis Creek flowing westward into the broad green-gold quilt of the Willamette lowlands. Those faded in turn to the blue line of the Coast Range on the very edge of sight. Even to keen young eyes on a day cloudless from horizon to horizon. Matilda crossed herself and touched her crucifix to her lips for an instant. "God made all lands beautiful in their own way," she said. "But this is our way, or part of it. For Rudy and Matilda, not just the king and queen. It's a good thing to have your heartstrings rooted in one place, small and very dear," he agreed. "You build from there. But it's the foundation, as the love of your kin is the starting place for a regard for folk in general." When he'd left this place 2 years ago to journey to the sunrise lands and return, there had still been a good deal of the boy in his face. Though he'd already been a warrior of note, and a chosen Tannist of the clan, successor to his mother as chief, there was little of that lad left, though the man the boy had become was contentedly relaxed for the moment. Living out a prophecy every day was much more wearing, he found, than simply living with one looming in his future had been. And you needed to take the moments of peace when you could.
"I like the beard," Matilda said, tickling his jaw.
He arched his neck and purred like a cat.
"Very distinguished looking. This time. Not mangy like the previous attempts."
"Like a wheat field struck by rust and weevils and blight, that was, the black sorrow and shame of it. But the third time's the charm."
"I remember when you were 16 and tried for a mustache. Your mother said, 'And aren't you getting old enough to shave that peach fuzz on your lip the now, boyo?' You blushed crimson."
The short-cropped growth was a slightly darker shade than his head hair, and had come in dense and even this time.
"It adds a few years to my looks," Rudy thought. "The witch cannot hurt when I'm dealing with so many touchy men and women of power. Human beings are like that. Buried memories of our childhoods, perhaps, when age is authority."
She sighed.
"Remember how we used to come up here as kids and lie finding shapes in the clouds?"
"It drove your attendants mad. Not that some of them ever liked your spending part of the year here."
"Those ones didn't last. Anyway, it was in the treaty."
Off to the left was the little waterfall, falling like a strand of silver lace over a lip of rock and into its pool. And below it, the dam and Corning gristmill, busy with grain from the just-completed harvest. Beyond that, the distant snow peaks of the high cascades glittered like islands of white against blue heaven in the east. The enemy held the bend country over mountain, up to the forts and the passes. To his right, he could just see the white stucco on the walls of dun juniper, and over it, a blink of paint and gilding from the chief's hall. The wind down from the crags carried a hint of the glaciers, and the strong, wild scent of the great fir forests that rolled mile after mile along the west-facing scarps.
"We're still driving them all crazy," Matilda said, "just in different ways."
The oval of pasture land and garden on the knee of the hill below was a little crowded, with tents in many of the paddocks, and far more horses than usual, including those of Dun Juniper's share of the eastern refugees quartered in every Mackenzie settlement.
"I wish we'd been able to do more than a flying visit in Portland and Castle Todenanks, though," she added. "They're home, too."
She was in a kilt and plaid herself, not for the first time. She'd spent half of every year here since they were both 10, back at the end of the War of the Eye, and had often gone in Mackenzie dress for convenience sake. Now it was also a statement that the High Queen belonged to all her peoples, not just her native Portland Protective Association, the same reason she'd taken to wearing jeans and turtleneck when they were in Corvallis. Which was wise, given the long and well-merited grudges many bore from her ghastly backlack of a father's reign and the wars against the Association. There were still people to whom the sight of a cotardi or hose in Hoopland were like a red rag to a bull. Some simply feared the Colossus of the North because it had more territory and as many people as all the rest put together. The War of the Eye had trimmed it back, but it had recovered quickly and had been growing steadily stronger in numbers and wealth and power, all three, under Sandra Arminger's steady, far-sighted rule. That had made everyone nervous until the rise of the Prophet and the Church Universal and Triumphant had buried old feuds in a common fear.
"Or the PPA outweighed all the other powers before we proclaimed Montival," Matilda murmured. "If you look at it in terms of everything from the Pacific to the Sioux Country, and not just as far as the Rockies, then the Association is cut down to size. and people may learn to relax about it a little.
Rudy chuckled. Their minds did tend to run alike. He'd heard that long-married couples were often so. They'd been wed about one turning of the moon, but he supposed being friends from childhood, as well as lovers now, hastened the process. Plus, both being the children of rulers, and extremely shrewd ones.
"But we have to win the war to make that more than a claim," he said, and kissed her.
The touch was soft and sweet, and he murmured,
"In the meantime, your wearing a kilt does have its merits."
"Eek, Rudy!"
He stopped, a little unwilling, even though he'd been playing.
"But we have permission from the gods themselves now," he said, teasing. "Yours in particular, since we were married in a Catholic church."
"Not in the open air. Someone might come by. I am Catholic, remember, not a witch girl."
"Nobody's coming by. Not with a Dane and a score of the High King's archers on guard."
"And they're too close."
He sighed dramatically.
"Alas, it's right you are. Their slight presence just out of sight would make for a little constraint."
"Just a little."
They rose, brushing bits of grass and the odd leaf off each other. Rudy put on his flat Scots bonnet with a spray of raven feathers in its clasp. There was a clump of meadowsweet growing half a pace away. He made a sign of apology and murmured,
"Let us share your beauty for a while, little sisters."
As he bent and plucked them and wove a garland,
"My thanks to you and her."
"There," he said, setting the lacy cream-white flowers on her head, binding the long, seal-brown hair that fell past her shoulders.
"Queen of the meadow, to crown my queen."
She kissed him again, and the sweet almond smell of the flowers encompassed them both.
"Duty calls,"
she said a moment later.
"In a shrill, unpleasant voice,"
he agreed mournfully. Reflex as deep as instinct made them reach for their sheathed swords, where they leaned against the tree with the belts wound around the tooled black leather of the scabbards. You didn't go a step without steel in reach. Rudy felt a slight, sudden cold shock as he touched his and swung the belt around his waist, doubling it and tucking the tongue under and settling the weight on his right hip with a twitch. He'd borne the sword of the lady for more than a year now, since that memorable day on Nantucket, and it still made the little hairs prickle along his spine every time he put his flesh to it anew. It was quiet today, or as much as the sword ever was. There were times a casual eye might have mistaken it for an ordinary weapon of extraordinary quality. The form was that of a knight's weapon, a yard of straight, two-edged, tapering blade with a slightly crescent-shaped guard and a double-lobed hilt of black staghorn. He gripped it and drew it slightly, enough for a handspan to gleam above the silver of the shape. Steel, at first glance. Then you could see the rippling, curling marks on it weren't Damascene work. They drew the eye inward, every pattern repeating, down and down and down, as if it was a window through the world. And the pommel, a sphere of crystalline moon opal gripped in antlers. Light swirled in it.
"Rudy!"
Matilda's voice was sharp as she called him back to the world of common day. He snapped the weapon home with a click of guard against shape.
"It's so creepy when you go away like that."
He looked up at her and smiled.
"Don't say it's always bad, Akushla," he said. "Here, put your hand on mine, and we'll see together what I glimpsed."
She did, where his left, his sword hand, since the wound that nearly killed him, leached a hair-fine edge of the strength and speed from his right, rested on the hilt. Then she gasped. Rudy went on one knee in this very spot, sinewy, wedge-shaped torso, brown and bare above his kilt. But older, a little, with scars she didn't recognize, and his hair longer and worn Mackenzie style, tied back with a spare bowstring into a queue. He smiled as he extended his arms, and a 2-year-old toddled towards him. A girl in a yellow shift, chubby feet bare, white silk hair falling around her shoulders, huge turquoise eyes sparkling above a gap-toothed elfin grin. Rudy seized her beneath the arms and tossed her high, catching her and tossing her again. Matilda watched, laughing, an infant in her arms. They took their hands from the sword and looked at each other, wondering.
Is that what will be?
She asked.
No. It's what might very well be, though. Which is close enough for government work this time as well, eh?
Making it so is up to us.
2 children, she said wonderingly.
He could hear happiness bubbling up beneath it.
In a few years from now, at least. And maybe more later. Oh, thank you, Holy Mary, Mother of God. My children. Our children.
A daughter and a son, Rudy added, nodding. Then his mouth quirked.
Crown Princess Orlaith and Little Prince John.
Matilda looked at him sharply. The order of succession hadn't been settled yet, whether it should be the eldest or the eldest son. The conservative nobility of the association mostly wanted the latter, of course, and he knew she was ambivalent herself. Then her eyes went wider.
You know their names. The sword knows their names?
Well, we could choose others now, just to spite it so. But they have a nice ring to them, don't they? So we might as well. Though it's most surely a matter of the snake biting its own tail.
Orlaith,
Matilda said.
That means golden princess, doesn't it?
So it does in the ancient tongue. Her hair will be like white gold as a child, and palest yellow when she's grown, with eyes like the sunlit sea. She'll be tall and graceful as a willow wand, stronger than sword steel.
He frowned seriously.
And she'll be mad for strawberries and cream in season, and love cats, and play the mandolin.
Matilda mock punched him in the chest.
Now you're making it up.
That I am. It's true about the hair and all that, though.
She paused for a moment.
And John. That was Dad's middle name.
And so it was,
Rudy said mildly, meeting her eyes.
I wouldn't have dared suggest naming him Norman. I know that's impossible. The politics.
Your father did great things, my heart, for good and ill. Let that part of him which did well and saved lives and built for the ages be remembered with a name. And the part of him that loved your mother and you. Let all else be forgotten.
Matilda looked away for a moment.
Thank you,
she whispered. Her father, Norman John Arminger, the first Lord Protector and founder of the PPA, had been a very able man. A warrior to be feared with his own hands, and himself fearless as a lion, and still more to be respected as a battle leader. Intelligent and quick-witted enough to see immediately what the change that stopped the machines meant, while others dithered and denied and died. And with power of will enough to inspire and bully others into following him. Without him, most of what became the PPA would have been ruins and charred bones split for marrow, and wilderness long since. He truly loved Matilda also, and in his odd way, her mother Sandra.
A strong man, Rudy thought, even a great one, but bad at the heart, though no man is all one thing.
As a ruler, he'd also been a brutal terrorist, an outright tyrant, both from policy and by natural inclination, and from a half-mad determination to bring his obsessions to life and imposed them as far as his sword's writ reached. One who killed with a relish and delight that would probably have appalled even his idols and models, William the Bastard, and Strongbow, and Bohemond, and Godfrey de Bouillon. Opportunities for that had been many in those early years of chaos and despair, when the most of humankind perished in a welter of famine and plague and desperate violence.
And 10 years after the change, he'd have killed me if Matty's mother hadn't hustled us out of his way after Tefane Dath rescued Matty from us Mackenzies and captured me in turn. Killed me with embellishments, just to give mother anguish, I think. His mind worked that way, the creature. But Sandra saw she might have use for me, even then.
Lady Regent Sandra Arminger was just as ruthless as her spouse had been. She was also even more intelligent, vastly more patient, and not hag-ridden by his inner demons. Since Norman's death at the end of the War of the Eye, she'd even been a good overlord to the Association from pure rational calculation. A hard ruler, very hard indeed, but not vicious. She had men killed without passion when she thought it necessary, like a croft wife picking a chicken for the pot, and with as little regret. In just the same spirit as she calculated taxes or which bridges needed repair, or how to balance factions in the dance of intrigue. She was even popular with the commons in the PPA territories, because the counts and barons feared and obeyed her, and she kept them in check and enforced the law on high and low alike.
Out of craftsmanship, I think. It's with good reason they called her the Spider of the Silver Tower. Yet she wept tears of joy when she saw Matilda again. And she raised Matilda. Me, too, when I was spending those months there every year after the war, as well as could be asked. Certainly we both learned much of kingcraft from her. We can never know the whole inwardness of another, nor all the paths their souls take from the eastern to the western gate, not even our own, until the dread Lord comes for us, and we stand before the guardians in the place where truth is seen whole.
Our children,
Matilda said again, leaning against him. When we've made a world safe for them, he said.
So, let's be about it, eh? We've troops to muster. Nearly as important, we need to get a better handle on what's been going on here while we were away questing for the sword.
Matilda nodded vigorously, her eyes going narrow with calculation. When she did that, she could look disquietingly like her mother. Rudy knew he was quick-witted. He suspected that in her way his hand-fasted wife was more intelligent still. More subtle, certainly. And perhaps a little more systematic.
And not just the big things. Battles won or lost, castles defended or not, she said. All the details. It's going to be crucial to manage the politics properly from the start. And we can't assume things stood still while we were gone.
That's my girl, he laughed. Though Chancellor Ignatius will have to take most of the burden for force. And I'll need him in the field eventually.
He's a very able man. And not from the Protectorate.
Sure, and that's one reason I appointed him. That, and being absolutely sure of him.
She frowned, still lost in thought.
And that's why I'm glad we sent your Aunt Astrid off on Operation Luthien.
I took your advice on that, Akushla, though it's a thin chance. But what's the relation?
Mom always said you have to remember that individual people exist in themselves. But things like nations and clans and armies and classes and religions only exist because people think they exist. They're not rocks. They're a swarm of people all flocking in the same direction. I mean, think of Montauval. It didn't exist 2 years ago, and now it does. And that's because we pretty much talked people into thinking it did. By letter at that.
The point, though we were pushing on an open door.
The folk wanted to believe in a dream of greatness, when people by the scores of thousands are convinced something is true, that truth can hit you very much like a rock.
Hence our problems with the Church Universal and Triumphant, and its prophet Sathas, the creature. She nodded.
That's so. But Mom also always said that when bunches of people are fighting against each other, whether it's with arms or words, you have to remember that they're not rocks colliding. They're people colliding. Every helmet has a head under it, and the head can think. The whole point of politics is to get people to do what you think they should. Bashing them is just one way of doing that. That's why Operation Luthien is so important. I think it might help us talk some people out of thinking that a certain set of rocks exist, and making them believe in our rocks.
With a sword in my left hand and you at my right, I'm going to be invincible, Rudy grinned. Then, more soberly, though we'd best remember this is far bigger than either of us now. The story of many, and not ours alone. We may be at the center, but it's the wheel that matters, not just the hub. One arm went around her shoulders. He put the other hand's thumb and forefinger to his lips and whistled sharply. There was a moment's silence, and then figures with long yew bows in their hands came trotting down out of the trees, hard to see at first in their green-covered brigandines and Mackenzie tartan kilts and plaids. As they formed up around the High King and Queen for the walk back to Dun Juniper, one began to sing, and they all took it up. When he recognized the tune, so did Rudy, despite Matilda's laughing gesture of protest. Near Sutterdown, in the country round, one morning last Beltane, down a boreen green came a sweet colleen, and she was whistling Rudy's tane. She looked so sweet from her sandaled feet to the sheen of her nut-brown hair. She's a coaxing elf, sure I shook myself, to see if I was really there.
That song's a mutilation, Matilda said. I've heard the original.
I call it an improvement, Rudy said. This isn't Erin, after all. And he continued in a strong tenor. From Ashland's plays up to Portland's quays, from Ben down to Coos Bay town. No maid I've seen like the fair Colleen that I met near Sutterdown. As she onward sped, I shook my head, and I gazed with a feeling rare. And I said, says I, to a passerby, who's the maid with the nut-brown hair? He smiled at me, and with pride, says he, that's the gem of our own clan's crown.
Chapter 2. Shattuck Hall, Temporary Chancellery. Crown City of Portland. Formerly, Portland, Oregon. Portland Protective Association, High Kingdom of Montevall. Formerly, Western North America. July 31st, change year 25, 2023 AD.
My Lord Chancellor,
his executive assistant said.
Abbot Bishop Dimvosky to see you.
Thank you, Ms. Wong, Ignatius said, with a polite nod. Many hats to keep straight, he thought. The title still felt a little unnatural. Though at present, with the hood of his scapular thrown back, there was nothing between his tonsured head with its rim of raven hair and the ceiling. He was a slim, broad-shouldered man of medium height, with a pale, weathered, regular face and slightly tilted black eyes, the legacy of a Vietnamese grandmother brought back here after some half-forgotten war of the ancient world.
Knight brother of the Order of the Shield of St. Benedict, priest, Lord Chancellor of Montevall. Remember that names do not make the man. You are a human soul like uncounted millions more. The smallholder's boy baptized Karl Bergfried, as precious to God as they, and no more so.
Please send him through immediately, he went on. Then the mustering reports from the Ashland. No, it's the Lou matter, isn't it? He concealed a rush of embarrassment at her raised eyebrow. Adjunct Professor Felicia Wong was from Corvallis, part of the University Faculty of Administration there, which meant that she was a junior to middling-level bureaucrat on secondment from the city-state's government and hoping to get in on the ground floor of the new High Kingdom's administration. Faculties were the term Corvallans used for what most people called guilds. A little confusingly, they were also part of the university's teaching structure. Like their terminology, they also insisted on dressing in what Ignatius considered an absurdly archaic manner. In her case, a turtlenecked knit shirt, a tweed jacket with leather patches on the elbows, blue denim trousers, and a painstaking modern recreation of an old-world type of shoe known, for no discernible reason, as a sneaker. She was also hard-working and efficient, and everyone was entitled to their foibles. Even if she was in her early 30s, scarcely older than he. Effectively, they were as much changelings as those born after that day in 1998.
"Yes, my Lord Chancellor. The Liu children are expected momentarily."
"Notify me when they arrive."
"I have been lurching from emergency to emergency all month. This lack of system wastes time. But there is no time to introduce a system. I must delegate more. But there is no time to test and come to know my subordinates. I must know more. I have been absent for 2 years, but there is scarcely a moment to spare to read, think, or question people."
She left and held the door for the next entrant. A clicking noise of counting boards and scritch of pens came through from the open plan spaces beyond, and the clatter and ring of typewriters and adding machines. Ignatius rose from behind his desk and advanced with a smile of relief. The man was in his 60s, twice Ignatius's age, balding and white-haired, with penetrating blue eyes under tufted brows, but likewise in the simple black Benedictine habit. Around his waist was a broad leather belt with a plain cross-hilted longsword, a dagger, a rosary and crucifix, and a buckle bearing the shield and raven badge of the Order of the Shield of St. Benedict that he had founded.
"Don't be excessive, Ignatius," he told himself. "Yes, he is a very intelligent and holy man. But you are not the hero-worshipping novice Karl Bergfried anymore. You have your own tasks to do, and cannot always run to the Reverend Father for reassurance."
Dymbosky had been thicker set than the younger man, but was growing gaunt, and stooped a very little now. Ignatius bowed and kissed his bishop's ring.
"Are you well, most reverend father in God?"
Dymbosky shrugged.
"At my age, and in this world of ours, a man is either well or dead, my son," he said. "At present, I am consumed with curiosity at this task you have for me. Curiosity and eagerness."
Ignatius indicated a chair and poured cool water before he resumed his seat behind the desk. The day was hot for Portland, probably over 80. Dymbosky removed his sword belt and racked it beside Ignatius's on the stand to the left of the door before he sat.
"I ask you only because, Reverend Father, you are one of the few able men I know who is not impossibly busy, merely very busy."
Dymbosky nodded.
"The forces of the Order and of the lay militia of the Queen of Angels Commonwealth march even as we speak. The Abbey and its daughter houses and the civil administration are functioning well."
"I expected nothing else," Ignatius said. "It's not the first time we've marched north towards Portland."
They both appreciated the irony of that. The last time it had been to fight the Association, at the Field of the Cloth of Gold, at the end of the War of the Eye.
"And now?"
He indicated his desk as he sat behind it. It wasn't precisely cluttered. He was a man of painstaking neatness, the habits of a monk and a soldier and an engineer combined. But it was certainly crowded. And it also held a tray with the remains of a working lunch of bread, butter, cheese, sausage, and a vegetable salad. The room was brightly lit by an overhead skylight, but the shabbiness of long disuse lingered in corners that had evaded a whirlwind of hasty patching and renovation. I am in the midst of trying to erect the skeleton of an administrative structure to coordinate our efforts while His Majesty fights a major war. All in the course of a month, and without a legal or constitutional framework as yet. Not to mention no source of funds once what we brought from Iowa runs out.
I hope that is not self-pity I hear in your tone, my son. The reward for work well done
is more work, yes.
It seems the association is providing generous assistance,
Dymbosky said, a slight dryness in his tone. As you see, rather too much so. That is why I picked this building, unused since the change, and obviously temporary. It would have been easier just to use the Lady Regent's administrative apparatus.
Which would have meant a most unfortunate precedent, and all the other states would be justly terrified that the new kingdom is the association in disguise.
Yes, Dymbosky said. Your lecture to the novices on that curious old concept of initial path dependency suddenly seems much more relevant, Ignatius said. They shared a brief chuckle. The order was a militant offshoot of the original Benedictine house at Mount Angel. That mutation had been a necessity of survival in the terrible years, approved by the church a decade later when contact had been restored with the new Pope and Curia in Badia. It had organized an enclave of survival, and it had played a significant role in the wars against the Association and Norman Arminger's schismatic antipope, Leo. In the years since, the Order had helped bring civilization back to remote areas, spreading skills, teaching, and guarding. That necessarily meant a fairly close acquaintance with politics, if only to protect their bailiwick around Mount Angel and the daughter houses. In all that time since the War of the Eye, Sandra Arminger had played the part of a loyal daughter of the faith with smooth skill, and used the church in the PPA lands as an instrument of her rule whenever she could. The arrangement wasn't completely one-sided. It had kept up and consolidated in less violent form the momentum of conversion that had started with Norman Arminger's motto of "Kiss the cross or the sword." The dangers were still all too apparent. They were both morally certain that she had had Leo assassinated as well during her house cleaning after Norman Arminger's death. The timing of his mysterious collapse had simply been too convenient. That knowledge went silently between them in a glance, and Ignatius murmured, "When a man causes you a problem."
"Remember, no man, no problem," Dymbosky finished for him.
"Fortunately, our new High Queen will be quite a different type of ruler, and she is now very close indeed to her delayed majority. Early next year, in fact. That will make her Lady Protector of the Association, as well as High Queen of Montauban."
"Yes," Dymbosky said, "and she really is a loyal daughter of Holy Mother Church."
"Which does not mean she will necessarily defer to a cleric's political opinions, of course," Ignatius said. "I know her, and believe me, that is the case."
"Nor should she. However, she will not necessarily defer to her mother's opinions either, close as they are. Yet the Association's apparatus is one designed by and loyal to her mother. Even when Norman Arminger was Lord Protector, she managed the detail work. It is a tool shaped and fitted to her hand. You do quite right to build anew, my son, even in these desperate circumstances. Institutional inertia is a very powerful force, which, as Catholic clerics and heirs to 2,000 years of it, is something we should know down in our bones."
Ignatius nodded. "I am improvising, and pulling in whatever personnel I can from wherever I can get them. But there is method in my madness. It keeps things fluid. and every power in our new Montaval is, of course, fully occupied with mobilization for the campaign to come, down to the littlest autonomous village. If it were not for the fact that all the other powers were jealous of the association.
And each other, Demboski added.
And each other. And hence anxious to have their people involved. I could never have pried loose a single clerk.
And I am whatever you can get as well, my son?
Ignatius flushed slightly, despite the detached amusement in the abbot bishop's voice. I am attending to political tasks His Majesty understandably cannot do in his own person, yet recognizes are utterly essential. He must have the support of the realm. And what is that, if not a political matter? And for that, I need your help. Demboski nodded slowly.
Which speaks well of him, the older cleric said. I knew he was a very able field commander, but a king requires far more than that. More than a charismatic presence as well. He must be able to govern, or he is a disaster in the making. Especially in a new kingdom without a cushion of institutions and traditions.
Ignatius spread his hands. Even before the sword, his grasp of detail was phenomenal. Since then, miraculous. And I mean that in a fairly literal manner, Reverend Father. Yet he can still only be in one place at a time.
I presume from the files you sent me that your request has something to do with the problem of the false Church Universal and Triumphant's infiltrations here.
Ignatius nodded. Precisely. Most particularly the matter of House Liu. This is not simply a political matter, either. Their mother's machinations may have begun that way, as a plan to make their brother Odard Lord Protector. But her contacts with the Church Universal and Triumphant quickly became more than that. Spiritual elements seem to have been involved.
Infernal elements. And there is no spoon long enough to sup safely in that company. She went from ally to unwitting tool to possessed rather quickly,
Demboski said grimly.
I understand that you had direct experience with agents of the cut.
Ignatius crossed himself and shivered slightly. And only by the very great mercy of God and the Virgin was I able to cope with them.
You are fortunate, my son. The Queen of Angels has taken a very personal interest in you, and you are hence protected against this filth. For those less armored in faith, it is a contagious, foul leprosy of the soul.
Ignatius blinked at the choice of words. Demboski was usually a very temperate man. Then he recalled looking into eyes that were windows into nothing, whose very existence was a wound in the fabric of the world and an invitation to the mortal sin of despair. He shook his head, refusing to be daunted. The matter of the Lu family is very delicate. Baron Gervais, Odard Lu, was one of our companions on the quest. By the end of it, at least, he was a true comrade, and he saved us all several times.
This bureaucratic morass must seem infuriating beyond bearing by contrast, Demboski said.
Am I so obvious? Ignatius said. It is valuable work, and the quest was often a nightmare. Hunger. Thirst, heat, cold, battle and perils, constant fear for my companions, constant worry for those back here at home facing the enemy.
A single comprehensible aim to which you could devote heart and soul. The company of honorable friends who became as dear to you as brothers and sisters. Each day a new vista and a new challenge. The inexpressible glory of a direct vision of the Virgin. Calling you to be her chosen knight.
Ignatius laughed. I am so obvious, then. Yes, this is almost squalid by contrast. Absolutely essential, though. And I must not let my life be one long declension from a moment of glory. I must make that a beginning, and this work also an offering to him. The cross I am called to carry up to heaven's gate. Dymvosky nodded.
I do not blame you in the least if you find that difficult. Let difficulty be a spur to effort. And even in your very bare bones reports, my son, it is obvious that everyone on that quest, with the exception of Baron Odard's traitorous servant Alex, saved each other many times. I was a soldier before I became a monk or a priest. And then after the change, soldier and monk and priest as well, as you are now. I know the strength of those bonds. The exhilaration of shared danger is not necessarily sinful, so long as it does not become an addiction.
Even Alex Vinton saved the princess, the High Queen, at least once, though without intending anything but treachery.
So does God turn even evil to the service of good,
Dymvosky agreed. And I am doing essential work here. Yet it will be a relief beyond expressing if you can lift some of that burden from me. And frankly, the tale of the quest to Nantucket and the sword of the lady is also an important element in rallying support to the new kingdom.
What is a kingdom, if not a tale that many agree is true? Or a nation, if not a collection of shared stories? To lead is to tell stories through action, to embody them and give them substance. We shape them, and then they shape us.
Ignatius nodded. So, if we emphasize the, cleanness and loyalty of the younger generation of House Lu, it will be useful politically. It will also show that the High King is not biased against the Association's nobility, either. They are half at least of Montevall's military power, and must be, kept sweet.
I should be glad to help, my son.
Ignatius sighed slightly.
I expected that, but it is so good to hear it. And the abbot has always had a gift for dealing with the young. I knew a little of these matters as they occurred, Dymvosky said, and I have studied the papers you forwarded. The Lady Regent Sandra was always a little obsessive about complete files on every conceivable matter.
For which, thank God, Ignatius said sincerely, and crossed himself again. This matter is personally important to the High King and Her Majesty as well. They have sworn to protect Baron Odard's younger brother and sister. Her Majesty promised it to him as he lay dying. But it is also important that they gain an overview of how it relates to the larger problem. We must defeat the cut in battle. But in the longer run, its remnants will be a severe problem, perhaps even a mortal threat. Ah, the children have arrived, though they were not really children anymore. Iso was a striking yellow-haired maiden of 17, with delicate umber-tinted features very slightly marred by four small, deep, pinhead-sized scars on the left side of her face, one at the corner of her eye. She wore a plain gray robe and white wimple, the habit of a lay postulant ordinary of the Sisters of Compassion. Her long, slanted blue eyes were slightly haunted, and she was limping a little from an injury about which the records told a remarkable story. Huon was younger and darker, 15, and obviously shooting up, in a page's outfit with the arms of the Barons of Malala on its chest, the lion and assegai quartered with the Mon symbol of House Lu. Both of them looked more than a little apprehensive as they made their curtsy and leg forward bow, respectively, and then turned to kiss the bishop's ring. Their past year had been traumatic, to say the least.
You are not in trouble, my children, Ignatius said warmly. Quite the contrary.
I was with your brother Odard for over a year, all of the way from Odell to the Sunrise Ocean. The second Baron of Gervias was a very brave man, a loyal comrade and a true knight, whose name will live forever when honor's praise is sung. One whom the High King has several times said to me, he sorely misses at his right hand. I heard his last confession and administered the sacraments to him. He died in great hope, and I think that hope was justified. His last request to the princess, High Queen, was that she take you under her protection, and that she swore to do. The youngsters relaxed a little, though both were still a little wary under impeccable manners. Their lives have been so much disrupted, Ignatius thought. Their brother gone, their mother a traitor, to God as well as the realm, and unpleasantly dead. Themselves under virtual house arrest, and then the direct attack of the Cut's powers. Also the result of their mother's folly, ably abetted by her brother. Young Lord Huon, I am directed by their majesties to assure you that you are confirmed as heir to the barony and lands of Gervias upon reaching your majority, and that there is no question of attainture for the actions of your mother and uncle. You will understand that the Lady Regent felt this matter had to be reserved for their majesties' final judgment.
Yes, my Lord Chancellor.
Furthermore, your education has been severely disrupted by the unfortunate events. Her Majesty is now forming her own household, a riding household primarily, a fighting meanie for the duration of the war. You have completed your time as a page, and Lord Chaka gives you excellent recommendations. It would therefore please Her Majesty to take your oath as squire. Ignatius folded his hands on the desk and went on gravely. I can testify from personal experience that Her Majesty is a knight of no mean skill with her own hands, and she will often be in the forefront at the High King's side or on independent commands of her own. As her squire, you would share in her perils and her achievements. This is a post of both honor and danger, in which you will be given the opportunity to show what is in you. Do you accept? Huon flushed crimson, stammered, nodded wordlessly, and then nodded quickly again. It was also a public affirmation of his family's loyalty and a promise of great preferment, if he showed well. A plum position at which any young nobleman would jump. After a moment, he spoke.
Yes, my Lord Chancellor. That is, if Lord Chaka agrees. Lord Chaka has been very kind to me when it was, politically and physically dangerous to be anywhere near me, and I would not desert him.
He has given his consent, and... Ignatius looked down at a letter. Says you show promise, and that he wishes he could have been a better master for you as a page, for your brother's sake, and for your own. Do sit, young man. Huon sat, nearly collapsing into the chair and looking rather stunned. Ignatius turned his attention to the boy's sister, standing with her hands modestly clasped before her, and obviously happy for Huon. My child, I understand that you have a special devotion for St. Bernadette of Lourdes. I take it you do not feel a vocation for the life of a religious, though?
No, Father, my Lord Chancellor. That is, I've wondered and prayed, but I want to be married and have children and a home of my own some day, though I've been glad to be useful with the sisters.
It is good that you know your mind and heart, Ignatius said robustly. We are not all called to make the same sacrifices, and a vocation must be firm and unambiguous. If there is doubt, the answer is no. According to your superiors, you have worked well and uncomplainingly with the wounded. Her Majesty instructs me to tell you that when matters are more settled,
when we know we're going to survive the next year as something besides guerrillas in the hills,
went unspoken among them. She will take you into her own household as lady-in-waiting. Furthermore, she will settle lands on you from the crown domain, several manors, to be held by you in your own right for life as a tenant-in-chief of the crown, and to descend to the heirs of your body,
as to the matter of your marriage. That will be taken under consideration in due course, in consultation with you and your brother. There's no hurry. Her Majesty does not approve of early marriages. And in memory of your elder brother, their Majesties will stand godparents to your children and your brothers, when they come, which God grant. It was Iso's turn to flush and look dazed. She'd been turned from a dubious prospect to a prize catch in one stroke, and given a promise she could take her pick of the suitors she'd eventually have, rather than be played as a card in the game of politics. In fact, with manners of her own, she could take a landless man if she preferred him. Godparenthood was also something their generation took very seriously indeed. It was called compadrazgo in the association territories, and established lifelong bonds almost as strong as kinship by blood. To have the right to call the High Queen comadre was a cadeau of incredible value. Ignatius chuckled slightly. "Don't look quite so stunned, my children. I didn't speak lightly when I said how highly their majesties held your brother in their esteem. He is sorely missed in this time of war and trial. He would have been trusted with the most vital missions and highest offices if he had lived." Then, gravely, "Take him as your example in loyalty and service, and you will find the High King and Queen very faithful friends and good lords, and House Liu will rest secure in their favor."
We will, my Lord Chancellor,
Huan said fervently. "And your service can begin now. Abbot Bishop Dimboski has kindly agreed to take charge of preparing a full report on the attacks by the Cut on your family. On the quest, we suffered from the attentions of the Diabolists, but you fought the same fight here."
"Which is a tactful way to put it, but for the best. We need to draw a line beneath the machinations of their mother and uncles."
"Lord Huon, you'll need a few days to outfit yourself before you join Her Majesty, probably in Goldendale. Here is a letter of credit for arms, horses, and field gear, and a note giving you precedence. I would appreciate it if you and your sister would cooperate with the good abbot while you're preparing."
"We will stop at the inn where I am staying for a little while," Dimboski said, as they made their way out onto Park and turned onto the thronged sidewalks of Broadway. Shattuck Hall was near the southern part of modern Portland, with the city wall curved in towards the Willamette along the eastern edge of the old Interstate 405. The shadow of the great works of the Barber Gate reached almost as far as the street where they stood, and you could see the towers of the outworks on the other side of the highway, tall on the hills that guarded the approaches. Edged metal blinked there as sentries paced the ramparts, and a blimp-shaped observation balloon floated in the sky above at the end of the long, graceful curve of its tethering cable.
"I will return you to good Sister Cecilia at the War Ministry, and she can escort you back to Bethany Refuge when we are done for today, Lady Iso. Or your brother could escort you, if you feel the need for some private conversation."
Huan Liu nodded.
"He seems okay," he thought.
The Order of the Shield of Saint Benedict had a reputation for severity in the association territories, but its founder scarcely seemed the ogre that legend made him. If you subtracted the black robe and the sword belt, he seemed like everyone's favorite uncle, in fact, or a good-natured but shrewd teacher. Huan exchanged a quick glance with his sister, and they shared a wary nod.
"We've always been close," Huan thought. "After the last couple of years, we're each about all the other has left, though."
"I am not simply going to ask you questions, my children. I am going to tell you things as well. Nothing will be withheld. You have a right to know the whole story of what has happened to your family, and how it bears on the kingdom and yourselves. I have the time for this, you understand. While Father Ignatius..."
They both nodded. The Lord Chancellor had been opening a new file even as they left,
gnawing absently on a heel of bread as he did. The office building that he'd picked was a little out of the way and had been vacant since the change. A low, nondescript brick structure, convenient because of its location, its position on the preventative maintenance list, and the fact that the pipes could be turned back on for city water. Huon was glad to be out of the slightly musty scent of a building unoccupied for 25 years. Most of the time his generation were thoroughly indifferent to the world before the change. But settings like that could give you a slight subliminal knowledge that the present was built on the bones of 6 billion dead. And
told everything. That's a change from being treated like a mushroom, he thought with a sudden eagerness. It's going to be fun being the High Queen's squire, but I'm still sort of burning a bit over the way we were kept in the dark about things. I suppose it was necessary, but that doesn't mean I have to like it. The Lady Regent, is tighter with information than she is with money, and that's saying something.
He felt a slight guilty spurt of pleasure when he thought of the letter of credit in his belt pouch after years on a close allowance while Barony Gervias was under crown wardship. He could run amok through the quality armorers that catered to the nobility, even with the war. No need to accept good enough armory standard gear. It was even justified, since he was going to be a royal squire. He had to show well to do his patron credit.
And horses, he thought. A pair of rouncies and a good courser. Maybe even a destrier.
Destriers were the ultimate luxury. They cost many times what a suit of plate armor did, and wore out much faster.
If I bought a young one, just out of a training farm, he would still be in his prime when I'm old enough to fight as a man-at-arms. That's only 3 years or so from now, and he'd be really well used to me by then.
Iso gave him a sharp elbow in the ribs, and he glared back. They knew each other too well to hide much, even of their thoughts. Then he smoothed his expression. He had a feeling that the elderly cleric didn't miss much either. Most of the gathering troops were passing directly east, or were being held in tented camps outside the city walls, but there were armed men in plenty. Noblemen and officers clutching papers as often as swords, afoot or on horseback or in pedicabs, with sergeants on bicycles or trotting doggedly with a rasp of hobnails on asphalt and cement. Most of the traffic was freight, though. Endless wagons of grain, barreled hardtack, racked armor, crossbows, and the salvage metal and timber and leather that the city's craft guilds and factories would transform into the sinews of war. The noise was a continuous grumbling roar. Voices and steel-shod hooves clattering hollowly on pavement, and steel wheels grinding on the steel rails of the city's horse-car network. The inn was not far away, and had been a hotel before the change, called the Benson, after some lord of old. It occupied most of a block, 3 stories of pale terracotta and many more of brick above, graded by ease of access. The reception rooms and dining chambers and kitchens were on the first two. The guests of rank on the next pair, those of more humble background on the 3 above that, and the rest fading up through servants and attendants to the hotel staff themselves. Right now, more than a dozen miniature heraldic shields were hung beside the main doors, showing that guests of a migerous family were staying. Knights and lesser nobles who had no townhouses of their own and rented suites here instead for themselves and their families and retinues when duty or pleasure called them in from their estates. Huon read them as casually and automatically as he would have so many printed signs. They flanked a larger fixed shield bearing a Madonna and child. The Virgin was Portland's patron. The staff were dashing around looking harried themselves, but one man with a towel over his shoulder showed the bishop and his party to a corner booth of the big common room with its cut glass wall at one end. The good odors of cooking overrode the city smells of smoke and horses and sweat and wool. They were not far from the riverside docks, where barges and the craft that plied the Columbia above its joining with the Willamette unloaded. Even ocean-going ships came upstream from Astoria sometimes, and they added their tang of bulk produce and salt fish and exotics like sugar and coffee and indigo and tea to the symphony of scents. It was all exciting, and would be even in peacetime compared to the quiet routine of a castle or manor, though he didn't think he'd like it for more than a visit. The great walls and towers that surrounded Portland made it immensely strong, but they also gave an uncomfortable sense of confinement. You could get out of a castle quickly, at least, and most of them had green fields right up to the moat. A swift look at the menu chalked on a blackboard made him dither a bit, but he so had been teasing him about always getting the same thing. He forewent the double bacon cheeseburger and had the souvlaki and pita with fries and a Portland Crown Ale. He so chose the batter-fried sturgeon with a salad and a glass of white wine, and Dimboski settled for bread and a piece of grilled fish.
"It's not a fast day, is it, Most Reverend Father?"
Huon asked, with a prickle of stricken embarrassment. He wasn't as devout as his sister, but he tried to do the right thing. Iso shook her head doubtfully, then pulled out a little bound book of hours and checked the reference table at the back as the platters arrived, to be sure. Dimboski chuckled.
"Just father will do, my children. No, it's simply that at my age the fire needs less fuel. Fat monks are figures of fun for good reason."
He pronounced a short, brisk grace, and they fell to. Huon was feeling hungrier than usual, since he'd been too nervous to do breakfast any justice. Dimboski nodded at his appetite.
"You, on the other hand, are building bone and muscle yet, my son. Give me your hand for a moment."
He did, and they squeezed. The soldier monk's grip was astonishingly strong for a man his age, and felt as if it had been carved from an ancient, dry-cured ham.
"Good," the cleric said. "Lord Chaka's report did say that you were shaping well. What is the first thing you wish to know?"
Huon opened his mouth, closed it again, and thought. He was warmed and irritated both when Iso gave him an approving look. And though Dimboski's face was calm, he thought there was something similar in the monk's blue eyes.
"I'd like to know what really happened with our... with Barony Gervias, contingent at the Battle of Pendleton. With my uncle."
"Sir Guelph Mortimer, your mother's brother."
"Yes. I know something went badly wrong, father, at the battle, or just after. And there are all sorts of rumors. But our men are not cowards."
"No, they are not,"
Dimboski said. He frowned, tapping his fingers together.
"In fact, they did rather well."
When he went on, his tone was dry, the voice he would have used to speak to an adult.
"What happened was this. The allied powers of the Corvallis meeting, we were not yet Montauban then, Rudy Mackenzie and the Princess and the other questers were still struggling through eastern Idaho, tried to steal a march on the Cut and Boise and seize Pendleton. That was just a little under 2 years now. We meant to strike before its boss man could make a pact with him, and they could send troops to secure the city and its territories. Unfortunately, it turned out that they had stolen a march on us. As nearly as we can tell from reports and interrogations later, what happened is..."
Huon leaned forward as the old soldier monk spoke. The room around them faded away. He could smell the oiled metal of armor, feel the fierce interior sun. Pendleton Roundup Territory, City of Pendleton, formerly Northeastern Oregon. September 15th, 2021. Change year 23.
"This is not going to be a good day."
Sir Guelph Mortimer of Lowiston Manor frowned down at the map spread over the gritty soil and weighed down at the corners with chunks of volcanic rock. It showed the city of Pendleton, capital of the Roundup Territory, or the associated communities of the Pendleton Emergency Area, if you wanted to be technical, which he didn't. He could look up and south across the river and see the low, rough-built walls with bits of rusty iron showing where the reinforcement cropped out through the concrete and rubble and odd angles where buildings had been incorporated into the defenses. Modern Pendleton was a rectangle, roughly, on the south bank of the Umatilla River. That acted as a natural moat on three sides. Sir Ruffin Velen was delivering the bad news. He was the Grand Constable's second in command right now, a hard-looking man in his 30s with thinning brown hair and one of her vassals and hatchet men. You had to be careful around them. They'd been the Lady Regent's kill squad before Baroness Dath went into the mainline military. He wasn't going to take Ruffin on lightly. To feign Dath made his skin crawl. He wasn't the only one. Nor was the regent called the Spider, without good reason.
In fact, it's going to be a very bad day,
Guelph thought. He was the head of the Barony Gervias contingent here today, as senior fighting vassal in the absence of his nephew, Baron Odard, who was off somewhere to the east on a quest like something out of one of the Dunedain storybooks, hopefully making the runaway Princess Matilda helpless with admiration of his heroism as they tailed along behind the Mackenzie brat.
And what I'm doing today won't be in front of a beautiful, well, passably good-looking princess who's heir to immense wealth and power. Hell, let Odard get her flat, and I'll be content to be his uncle and shake the patronage tree in his shade.
They'd been up before the dawn, working like mules to set up the siege machinery along the bank of the Umatilla. He was sweating like a pig inside his suit of plate and wishing he'd switched to an old-fashioned mail hauberk. The interior was still beastly hot this time of year, and they were a long way from the Pacific's cool breezes. Plate might as well be waxed canvas as far as keeping the air out was concerned. All he was getting was the occasional tantalizing draft through the joints when he moved. Little metallic clanks sounded as men jostled around the map and their harness rattled, or the leather straps and padding beneath creaked. The stated objective,
right up till now,
thought Guelph, casting an irritated eye at the quarter-high sun, had been to install the machines to sweep the bridges across the river, then advance to take out the city wall of Pendleton by the emigrant gate when the beaten forces of the Roundup tried to hold the city. Meanwhile, the rumor was that the Dunedain were to do something unspecified, but wonderful if it worked.
The whole operation got blown, Ruffin said bluntly. They pushed in more forces at precisely the wrong time for us. We don't have very much information yet, mostly from enemy deserters. But the Grand Constable...
Sir Ruffin was looking at Sir Erend Renfrew, who was also Viscount Chenoweth, heir to the Count of Odell, and his younger brother, Sir Terry Renfrew, who was something of an artillery specialist. Sir Guelph allowed himself the luxury of a grimace of distaste and a quick turn of his head and spit. With enough dust to make your teeth gritty every time you swallowed, no one could prove it was a statement of opinion. Of the Grand Constable, and of House Odell. Dath had been Conrad Renfrew's protege, as well as the Lady Regent's. The families were tight, part of the glacis around the Lady Regent's position.
Says we also have intelligence that we're facing almost twice the numbers we expected. Say 2,000 or 3,000 men each from Boise and the Church Universal and Triumphant, as well as the Pendleton troops we knew about.
That brought grunts. Everyone here could add.
They suckered us and got their forces in here first. We can't fight this one and win with what we've got here, and there's no way to get meaningful reinforcements in time to do any good. We need to break contact and retreat as far as Castle Ermiston on the old border. The fortifications there will give us an edge, and we can put in enough additional forces to make them think three times about trying to invest the castle."
Guelph growled at the thought of giving ground. He knelt next to Terry and traced the bridges over the Umatilla north of the walled city of Pendleton.
"They can cross these and flank us. We control the 18th Street Bridge and the footbridge next to it. But 10th, 8th, and Main are weak points. If we can cut those off, they'll have to go all the way up to Fulton."
His gloved finger traced north, over the river, and then back down.
"And sneak back down Highway 37 to get near us, which will give us the time we need."
Sir Ruffin nodded.
"So here's what we'll do. Sir Guelph, you'll take your men and neutralize those bridges. Caltrops, barbed wire, oil slicks. Burn them, saw them, fucking piss on them, whatever it takes. Just make them impassable for long enough, if you can't destroy them."
He turned to the scions of House Renfrew.
"Sir Terry, we're abandoning the siege engines, so you can start the teams and limbers out now. At least we can save the horses. You'll hold this headland until the evacuation is complete. Breaking contact is going to be a bitch."
Terry thought for a moment, then grinned like a coyote scenting a house cat.
"I think we can get some use out of the engines first, Sir Ruffin. There's only a couple of ways they can get at us here. If a place is hard to get into, it's usually hard to get out of as well. And if we channel them a bit, that narrows it even more. Done right, we can turn it into a real killing ground, and they'll lose all interest in chasing us for a while."
Sir Ruffin nodded. "Good. Use your discretion. I need you and you, my Lord Viscount, to hold here and get as much material out as possible, as well as the troops. We've got the pedal cars all set up. They'll go to Ermiston and return for a second trip, if possible. And anyone marching in that direction can hop on when they reach them. When you leave, take out these three bridges over the Umatilla."
Sir Ruffin marked a cross on the bridge at Highway 84, the Westgate Bridge, and the Rail Bridge. "They have to be impassable for at least 12 hours, more if possible. That'll bottleneck the enemy long enough, hopefully."
The elder Renfrew brother looked east.
"We don't have enough men for that, Sir Ruffin. If there's a sortie in any strength from the city to capture the engines, we'll be up Shit Creek, not the Umatilla River."
The Grand Constable's right-hand man nodded.
"I'll send a couple of convoy of men-at-arms and infantry to help you hold. Most of the fighting is down around the John Day Highway and south of the old Highway 84 and 30. That's where it looks like the battle line is shaping up. The enemy is anchoring their right on the city and trying to swing up north. We'll have to rock them back on their heels there. That's where we've got most of our lancers and the Mackenzie longbowmen. But this position has to be secured, or they can use their reserves to flank us out too soon. As soon as I can spring the men, I'll send them to you."
"What forces specifically, Sir Ruffin?"
the Viscount asked a little more formally. Ruffin chewed his lip and shook his head.
"How good are you at kicking butt? The only one I think we can detach is going to be from House Stavarov's contingent from County Chehalis. Sir Constantine and his meanie, you know."
"Piotr's brat. He'd better not mess with me."
"But he won't.
His reputation isn't long on discipline." The heir to Odell snorted.
"To hell with discipline, Sir Ruffin. He likes to fight. He's a complete loss at knightly courtesy and social graces. In fact, his vocabulary is limited to variations on drink and fuck and kill. But give him a chance to charge screaming at the head of his men-at-arms, and he's happy as a drunken pig in a grape vat. That maneuver is the limit of his military knowledge, but he does it well. And he'll take my orders."
Guelph glanced curiously over at the iron expression on Viscount Chenoweth's face, but decided not to ask. Sir Ruffin nodded and picked up the yard square map. Guelph hurried to help him shake it gently and roll it up. Map paper was horribly difficult to press evenly and cost the earth. Only the Albany presses of Corvallis made this grade of paper. He tapped it very carefully and slid it into the carry tube for Ruffin. The Viscount took off his helmet with a single pungent word as Ruffin mounted and left in a spurt of pebbles and dust, the pennons of his escort flapping as the lance heads glittered in the sunlight. He scrubbed his short, light brown hair and growled.
"Thank you so very much for this gift of a helmet full of horse turd, Sir Ruffin. Guelph, get your men. Take out those bridges. I don't need to teach you how to suck eggs. What the hell happened to the Dunedain? That op was tricky, but they pulled off harder. Beelzebub's arse with piles the size of plums. I wish I knew the details."
Guelph didn't answer, limiting himself to a duck of the head and thump of fist on breastplate in salute. He took off looking for Sir Harold Chesnecky, the other Javius knight here, and waved their squires forward. But he bared his teeth in a sudden, angry grin.
"The Dunedain, huh? Hope that bitch and her sidekicks all bought it. That would be a nice little dividend on Javius's arrears of revenge for my brother Jason's death back in the Protector's War. Baroness Mary will be pleased. And they promised me, uncle to the king, they did indeed promise me that. Which doesn't mean throwing this fight. Uncle to the king of as much as possible. That's the thing."
"Chezzy, get the meanie together. We're on dirty tricks. Grab some mantlets, one of Terry's engineering wagons, and let's go burn and destroy."
His men-at-arms and footmen.
Odard's men, he thought. But I'm here, and my nephew isn't.
Roared with pleasure.
"Valentine, Valentine, St. Valentine for Javius. Let the arrows fly. Valentine will suck them up. Face Javius! Face death!"
The battle banner of the barony waved in the hot sun with its black and red image of St. Valentine, transfixed with arrows, on a yellow background.
"Looks painful," he thought,
not for the first time. The crossbowmen slung their weapons and put their shoulders to the heavy wheeled shields, heaving them up on their props like wheelbarrows.
"Six men pulling! Six pushing on each!"
Guelph snapped.
"Get to it!"
The spearmen moved their shields to their right shoulders and fanned out in a protective screen between the mantlets and the city walls.
"Dismount the lancers," he decided. "We won't have time to get the mounts out, and war horses can't be wasted."
There was grumbling at that, but association knights trained to fight on foot when they had to, and being armored cap-a-pie, the men-at-arms would stiffen the footmen nicely. The mantlets trundled along, bouncing on their spoked steel wheels over the irregular ground.
"Idle bastards,"
Guelph said, looking around at the ruins of what had been Pendleton's northern half. Nobody had to ask who he meant. The wreckage of the suburbs here had mostly been left to decay naturally, with only occasional efforts to clear a field of fire on the north bank of the river. Or perhaps that was simply people salvaging building material. Concrete floor pads and basements and the ruins of burnt-out houses were still thick, and others had been converted into workshops or storage, or piles of rubble had been shoved aside for truck gardens and turnout pasture. There were even occasional rusted automobile hulks littering the dirt-drifted, sagebrush-grown roadways, though they'd been stripped of useful items like springs and glass windows, anywhere in the association territories, or at least anywhere with an inhabited countryside and a city in the middle of it, would have been a lot neater. The wagon with the engineering supplies followed behind, lurching and jerking as the heavy horses dragged it up the footpath east along the bank opposite Pendleton's walls.
"Keep going,"
Guelph called.
"Eighth Street first, then work your way back."
They broke out into the open country as they traveled, east of the ruined suburb. There was the 8th Street Bridge, the last one actually fronted by the wall of the smaller modern city on the south bank.
A couple of sentries pelted back across it, their yells thin with distance. A sally port beside the main gate opened for a second to their frantic pounding, and then slammed with a hollow boom as they dashed through. That looked as if everyone in the city was firmly focused on the battle shaping up to the southwest.
Good.
My lord, where should I put this stuff?
A sergeant asked, gingerly holding a cloth tube of the mixture of powdered aluminum and iron oxide.
The thermite? See there where the crossbeams are riveted to the main support pillars? Pack it in there! Crossbowmen here, ready to give covering fire!
The mantlets swiveled to face the city walls, trundled forward, and dropped on their support props with a thunk. The crossbowmen took position behind them, thumbing bolts into the grooves of their weapons and leveling them through the firing slits. Working parties scrambled down the steep slope to the foundations of the bridge, men standing on each other's shoulders to reach the vulnerable part he'd pointed out. Guelph sweated more than running around in a 60-pound suit of plate and carrying a 15-pound shield in 90-degree heat demanded. Pendleton was notoriously sloppy, but Boise was equally notorious for paying tight-arsed attention to detail. And the cut. His mind seemed to skip a beat. He blinked in confusion.
What was I about to think? What?
Done!
The sergeant called.
Light the fuse! Back west! Next bridge!
The river turned a little south of west. The Main Street Bridge was absurdly wide in the fashion of pre-change construction, and the banks of the Umatilla were forested here.
Sentries!
Yelled Sir Harold, pointing. Guelph looked up. Several men were standing on the wall, visible between the crenellations as light flashed off field glasses. One had a traverse crest of scarlet-dyed horsehair on his helmet.
Boise Centurion, that one, he thought. The rest are registered refugee regiment, no mistaking the red pants. The Pendleton bossman, Carl Peters, must have ordered some of his household troops to stay back and protect his precious hide.
Get going! They're not going to stay asleep forever!
Damn, he thought. It made sense to rush to the end of the job and work my way back, I thought. We have to take those down so they use the ones we want when they sally. At 500 feet from the wall to us. This one isn't safe. That's long crossbow shot. Much less the next one. It's barely half that. Should have taken the nearer ones out first before they got men here to harass the working parties. Crap. No help for it. Gotta get it done. They'll be waiting for us at 10th. Might even defend it.
Chansey! Grab 30 men in the wagon and go start on 10th Street. Be careful. Be smart, but get it down. Take 2 of the mantlets.
He turned back to the Main Street Bridge, wishing he had Terry's training as a field engineer. Crossbows began to twang and thump from the wall. Most of the bolts fell short, but he ordered spearmen forward to hold their shields up to protect the working parties. Just as they finished the work and were forming up, a scorpion was wrestled up onto the wall. Men looked up and yelled in alarm. They were well within range of the 4-foot bolts, and you couldn't count on a siege mantlet stopping them. Guelph laughed. It was even mostly genuine.
They haven't fastened that thing down, men!
Recoil would buck it right off the wall if they tried to fire it without a solid anchor. Pendleton was short of artillery. The Boise Army had probably brought in a lot, but there wouldn't be pre-fitted bolts ready to secure them on the walls. There were men working around it, probably trying to improvise braces.
Give them a salute, boys!
He turned his back on the wall, pulled the knot on his true's waistband, and mooned the useless scorpion. A knight's plate armor left the seat bare to grip the saddle.
Dangerous, he thought, but it puts fresh heart in the men.
The Gervias contingent roared and laughed and followed suit, waggling and slapping their buttocks at the wall and shouting remarks that started with, "Shoot this, you sheep fuckers," and went downhill from there.
The thermite charges lit with a hissing dragon's roar, and off-white smoke poured heavenward. Metal bubbled and ran, and concrete cracked with a snapping crackle. Guelph yanked his trews up, pulled a new slipknot, and pointed his sword west.
"Back! Let's help Chezzy stick it to them again!"
He led the way down the old footpath, mantlets clanking and rattling beside them. Over the rattling sound of his men double-timing and pounding unison, and the banging of the mantlet's steel wheels, came a sudden whoop, like an arrow hugely magnified.
"Hurry!"
he roared. The muffled impact came with a scream, high and pain-laden. Guelph pounded up onto 10th Street, into chaos. The men he'd sent were milling about on the ground. He clenched his jaw against the welling of despair. Chezzy and Chezzy's squire, Terry Reddings, a huge bolt transfixing his body. Terry was his wife's younger brother, and as like to Layella as a twin.
"God, thank you, he's face down. I couldn't bear to see his dead face. Her face, dead. She's not dead, she's not."
He laid about with the flat of his sword, banging on mail and shocking men back into sense.
"Get that mantlet set up! Get us some cover!"
He turned to see Father Stanion working on Chezzy.
"He's alive? What's happened to him?"
"Crossbow bolt on the scapular."
The doctor priest jerked a thumb to the right.
"They got a man over the wall, and he sneaked up close enough to take a shot. Young Reddings is dead, but Sir Chesnecki isn't. But the bolt hit a vein. Luckily, not an artery. I can't budge it, and we need it out to cauterize it. I have to get him back to the cars. Probably need to get him to Hermiston before we can do anything."
Guelph nodded.
"Brandon! Take 3 men for stretcher duty. Take Chezzy and Terry. Terry's body back to the railhead. Evacuate all non-essential personnel, now! Charlemagne! Get those drums unloaded all over the bridge! Spill the oil now!"
The flat tongue of the scorpion twanged again, and everybody threw themselves flat. This one was properly anchored, which meant they could reload it quickly. The bolt went overhead with a tooth grating whoop and then a whonk of impact as it buried half its length in the soil. They worked, using mantlets as best they could to shield themselves. Another bolt hit one, and half the shaft stood through it. A man stumbled back swearing as the sharp, three-sided head stopped a hand's breadth from his face, then dropped flat with a yell as crossbowmen volleyed at his suddenly exposed form. Beyond the walls, a slowly growing brabble sounded, pounding feet, equipment clanging and thumping against other men or walls and stairs. Shouts loud enough to be almost comprehensible. That meant hundreds of men at least, massing in the open space just inside the walls. When there were enough of them, the gates would spring open.
"They're getting ready to sortie," he muttered to himself. "And there's nothing much we can do but wait for it, and hope those Stavarov men get here the way Ruffin promised."
He looked up and was shocked to see the morning was gone and the sun was in the west. A squire handed him a couple of hardtack biscuits and a lump of rock-hard cheese strong enough to make you feel that it was biting you. And the sight brought on a sudden raw hunger that had nothing to do with taste and everything with fuel. He worried it both and drank from a canteen of Umatilla water cut 1-5 with bad brandy to kill the bugs. Then the banners of House Stavarov, a glitter of lance points and footmen trotting behind, just far enough away to see clearly as they reined in beside the flag of House Odell. He breathed out in relief. They might not be enough, but he certainly didn't have enough without them.
"Pile it all up!" he shouted. "The tents, the food! Tear down those corrugated iron sheds! There! 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 We'll stop them in these ruined streets just north of here!"
The stink of blood, sweat, spoiling food, dust,
oils, and distillates was compounded by the filth 300 men could void in a single day of hard and ceaseless work.
Go ahead and shit, pee, spit, and foul the nest. We'll either lie in our filth with the coming of dark, or leave them lying in it.
The last pedal cars were already pulling up on the rail line to the west, ready to take them out. Viscount Chenoweth, Terry, and Guelph met at the railhead. It was close to sundown.
"Are we about ready?"
Chenoweth asked.
"Yes,"
Guelph answered shortly. Then, seeing anger begin to darken the other's eyes, apologized.
"Too long a day and too much sun, my lord. What's the plan now?"
To his relief, Chenoweth nodded an acceptance for the implied apology.
"They're going to launch an attack soon. It must have taken this long to get enough troops up from the main battle south of town. Terry's specialists will fire the Highway 84 bridge the moment they do, then double time over to the Westgate Bridge and fire it with incendiary bolts from the prearranged positions. It's thick with the HD-40 now. We'll all converge on the rail cars."
Konstantin Stavarov's face fell.
"Well, fuck your mother! Don't I get to fight?"
"Yes, you do, Sir Konstantin," the Viscount said patiently. "You have to hit the head of their column when they come out of the city and across the bridge. Hold them. Then I hit them. Then Sir Guelph hits them in the flank. Then you withdraw, we withdraw, and we spring our little surprise on them when they're nicely stalled just where we want them. Understand, my lord?"
"Da, da! They come out and I charge them down this street here."
The heir to Odell's side.
"Exactly.
My lords, Sir Konstantin and his people will hold until we get there, and then take the first pedal cars off. Most of Terry's specialists will follow in the next two cars. They won't need their reloading crews, and the machines will be laid in advance."
Guelph nodded, frowning as he looked for his squires. Brandon and Charlemagne were back by the rails, arguing? He strode back, a blistering rebuke behind his teeth. They were confronting a child of 11. Odo Reddings, his wife's youngest brother, and his youngest page.
"God's teeth, Odo! I sent you back to Hermiston with orders to accompany the wounded into Portland hours ago. This is no place for a page."
Odo looked up at his lord, his defiant, angry attitude towards the squires crumbling.
"I miss the train, sir. Do I take the one with the Chehalis, meanie?"
"God, of course not. One of Constantine's knights. I know his reputation. I can't tell them Odo hid from his brother's dead body, but I'm sure that was it. Damn, I didn't think of that."
"Brandon, detail someone to get this brat on the train with you. And what is going on here?"
At the angry voice, Guelph turned, baring his teeth at Terry.
"A little bit of a snaggle. My page is still here."
"Get your men into position, Mortimer. I'm going up."
Guelph nodded, his cheeks burning with embarrassment.
"And Odo's butt is going to burn."
"Brandon, Charlemagne, back to your position. Sir Terry, the Padre will be at your orders. I'll see you at the rendezvous."
Guelph and his squires double-timed it to the formation point in the tangle of dead streets. As Guelph strode up the line, checking his men's readiness, he saw many reach for their scapular or the saint's medal they wore around their necks, murmur a brief prayer, and turn it back. With a sour smile, he did the same. The plain gold disc dangling on a fine gold chain around his neck was set with a small piece of jasper. Unless somebody took it in hand and looked at it, they wouldn't realize his old St. Valentine medal was gone, nor what the new one signified.
"The ascended masters are real. So is their power."
Then a shout of,
"Here they come!"
He skipped backward a few steps to get a line of sight. The city gates were open, and at least 200 men were quick-stepping out with more behind. The assault party was Pendleton City militia from the looks, wildly mismatched armor but long pikes, coming straight down the road to the bridge
and heading equally straight for Constantine's banner. His position would be invisible to them. Hopefully, until too late.
Face forward, all of you! When the signal comes, we're going to run down this street. Turn right! That's right, everyone! Into the cross street, and hit in a wedge, splitting the join between the Oregon City men and the enemy. I want you all to think that you're wild Celts, like the McClintocks, fangs out and hair on fire. We have to hit them like a sledgehammer. It's our asses if we don't. Charlemagne, you're there. Brandon, there.
He took his place at the head of the lines, spearmen and men-at-arms with their shields forward, the lighter-armed crossbowmen on the flanks.
Nobody look back! Everybody eyes front! You'll follow me!
He turned his head over his right shoulder, waiting for the flash of red, stamping his feet rhythmically and hearing the whole meanie take it up as they jogged in place. Just a few feet forward was the entrance to the north-south alley they had numbered 2. He could hear the fight struggling back and forth, like the sound of sea surf in a storm, as a bristle of long Pendleton pikes slammed up against the County Chehalis men-at-arms and spearmen. Chenoweth was at the other end, though he couldn't see them. Terry's flag signal would synchronize the attack. Terry's squire swung the red flag from his position on top of the post, and Guelph lifted his sword and knocked down his visor. The world shrank to a bright slit, and he put his left fist 4 inches below his chin. The shield covered him from face to knee, and he tucked his shoulder into it, making his armored body into a battering ram. Then he filled his lungs and screamed the order,
"With me! Forward!"
Everyone stepped off together, synchronized by their stamping unison. He moved at a trot, building momentum and speed as his meanie came behind him in a thick wedge of muscle and bone and steel and wood and leather, a harsh stink of sweat and oiled metal like a wave moving with them, a crashing rhythm of hobnailed boots and clattering steel. Voices echoed, muffled by the visors and booming from the curved inner surfaces of the big kite-shaped shields.
"Forward for Portland! Harrow! Face Gervais! Face death! St. Valentine, protect us! Harrow!"
Ahead, the clatter and thump of close-quarter combat, the unmusical crash of steel on steel, like scrap falling on a stone floor, the grunting and panting of the heavy shoving match, shield against point or shield, men crushed forward by the weight at their backs and forced into the enemy ahead, shocked screams of pain as steel bit home, shrieks of animal rage and fear, the patterned bellow of war shouts from the men of County Odell.
"Dismas, Dismas, St. Dismas, protect! Odell, Odell, Odell! Haro, Haro!"
They hit the enemy force, locked with the Odell and Chehalis men, and the sound turned shrill as they realized they were being flanked and the crossbow volleys struck home. He rammed his shield into a pikeman's unguarded right side with an impact that knocked into all his joints and the small of his back, smashed him off his feet and into the press of stamping boots below, and thrust over and down into a man's neck above the breastplate. The points of spears and gazarms slammed past him from behind, thudding home in faces and guts, or screeching off armor with tooth-grating, tortured squeals. Odell's oliphants were sounding retreat. Guelph kept his head moving as he fought. You had no peripheral vision with a visor down, but he could feel the Pendleton men crumbling. He could also see Konstantin Stavarov, shieldless, his visor knocked away, with blood spattered across his flushed, high-cheeked, snub-nosed face, and the white showing all around his eyes as he swung a two-handed warhammer with a thick spike on the other side in a blur of smashing, stabbing motion. He was either laughing or just giving a bestial roar of joy, mouth like a red and white cavern. It was impossible to hear him in the tumult,
but it was utterly obvious he wasn't going to obey any trumpet call to retreat, and probably hadn't even heard it. Two of his squires grabbed him neatly in what was obviously a rehearsed maneuver, each throwing an arm about him to pin his to his sides, pushing their shields forward to guard all three as they backed up with their lord's feet almost off the ground as he screamed and struggled wildly. Stavarov's meanie turned and ran west to the waiting rail cars and retreat. Viscount Chenoweth's men and Gwell's plugged the hole at the intersection, holding the enemy at bay while Terry's siege engineers and artillerists worked behind them in a ratcheting clack and clatter of machinery. Smoke billowed upward as the bridge was fired, black and oily and rank with the scent of burning petroleum seldom smelled these days. The Pendleton men crumbled away, but behind them were ranks of square hemispherical shields like sections of tower wall, each marked alike with an eagle and thunderbolts. The grim faces behind the low-domed helmets and face guards looked completely unfazed by being cut off from reinforcements by the fire. They moved in a unison like the bristle of a porcupine's quills around an eagle standard, and the points of long javelins cocked backward with a ripple on brawny, thick-muscled arms.
"Ware spears! Up shields!"
Guelph shouted, and he wasn't the only one. The kite shields came up, and the crossbowmen ducked and grabbed for their small steel bucklers. From the other side, a steady, unhurried bellow of,
"Pila! Ready! Front rank! Throw! Second rank! Throw! Third rank! Throw!"
A whistle of 6-foot throwing spears at less than 10 yards distance. Guelph grunted and took a step back as two hammered into his shield, then cursed and threw it aside as the long, soft iron shanks bent, making the defense useless. He tossed his long sword up, settling it in the two-handed grip and working his fingers in the armored gauntlets. The setting sun cast long shadows, and the rusty patchwork of the sheet metal building beside him reflected the red rays. Guelph felt squeezed like grapes in a press as the close quarters caused the sound to echo and re-echo up and down the hot, airless, man-made canyons.
"Charge!"
the enemy commander shouted, and the blatting tubi echoed it. The helmet standard moved forward, carried by a man with a lion-skin headdress over his helmet.
"Hoorah! Hoorah!"
chanted the Boise infantry, pushing forward, their short swords flickering out from the wall of shields.
"USA! USA!"
"Cut! Cut! Cut!"
came the eerie scream of the Church, Universal, and Triumphant's men, somewhere not far distant. Guelph wondered if any red-robed seekers were with them, but he was too busy flexing with his line. Swaying aside from the glaive that poked over his shoulder at the shield in front of him, the hook catching it and pulling it down, delivering a sweeping overarm cut onto a low-crowned helmet with all his strength and feeling something snap. The man in hoop armor fell, and the one behind him stepped forward into his position with stolid speed. No time to really think through the implications.
"Like two turtles," he thought,
as the lines drew apart for a few seconds, breathing hard. The dust, the smell of blood, voided bowels, and urine rasped at his throat, and the burning oil made him cough. He panted, mouth hanging open, ignoring the taste on his tongue. In front of him, he could see a Boise sergeant rallying his men for the next push, more confident as the PPA ranks moved back. They flexed, swords poked out, pole arms reached over the shields. Individuals pushed harder, probed for openings. Guelph grinned savagely as he lifted his sword overhand. The late sun was in the enemy's eyes, and he stabbed at a face. Chenoweth was by his side as they worked in tandem to hold the plug until Terry's men had done their work. He watched for the swath of whitewash on a wall by the side of the road that marked the prearranged spot.
The Boise men paused to regroup. Wounded dragged back, and fresh men stepping forward. New Pila handed forward too.
5, 4, 3, wait for it, 2, 1.
The Oliphant screamed.
Back!
He shouted. The Gervais men skipped backward, shields up but moving fast. Then, in one fluid motion, the PPA men threw themselves down, the front rank holding up their shields as they went to one knee. The Boise men drew back, paused, and in the instant were lost. All the siege machinery that would be abandoned had been pre-sighted on this spot. Behind each crouched a gunner with a lanyard in his hand. They jerked the cords in unison, and the murder machines flung their loads in a chorus like the harps of tone-deaf demons. Cast-iron round shot, darts, incendiaries lashed down on the small crowd of warriors. Men screamed as napalm ran down their shields and under their armor in splashes of clinging fire. Shields cracked under the round shot, and legs snapped like twigs as the 12-pound balls bounced and spun. At this range, 4-foot darts nailed men together through armor and shields back. Guelph stood, his balls crawling up inside as he saw what remained of the enemy rank. Smoke and flame billowed up behind them. Even if the asphalt of the surface didn't catch, it would be a while before anyone could cross that bridge.
It only takes one dart thrower, he thought.
Back! Retreat!
He shouted, and the Oliphants echoed it. He stooped and snatched up an intact shield someone had dropped.
Back! This place is rigged to burn! Fast! Fast!
The men turned and trotted away. Some of them had the arms of wounded comrades over their shoulders, and others were making rough carrying seats from two pairs of crossed hands. One giant even had an armored form slung across his back. The knights and squires were last, backing in a controlled rush and trusting to their fuller armor to shield their subordinates. Chenoweth's eyes flickering back and forth over the broken bodies they left behind. Guelph was doing the same. Stopping to pick up the dead was out of the question. Even the wounded weren't always possible. If they could recognize the fallen, it made it easier later to compile the lists of the dead. Then they were out, running, running for their lives to the rail bridge, 84 to the left, and Westbridge dead ahead, engulfed in flames. The warehouses behind them burst open like an overripe watermelon dropped off a castle's battlements, the stacked incendiaries collapsing as the thermite charges ruptured their glass walls. A wave of liquid fire poured out of the ruined buildings, running knee-high like surf on a beach. The screams of the enemy rose to a peak and then died as the fire ripped the air out of the narrow alley. Men fled burning. Even Boise's discipline couldn't take this. Guelph leapt aboard the first of his contingent's pedal cars, ignoring the Odell brothers doing likewise ahead of him.
"Push, damn you!"
Guelph screamed.
"Half push, half pedal!"
His men threw their weapons and shields on the cars. Some clambered aboard and threw themselves into the recliner seats, booted feet searching for the pedals. The rest rammed their shoulders into the sides so enthusiastically that Guelph had to grab for a support as his car almost came off the tracks. It began to rock forward with the rough, irregular, neglected bed giving it a sickening side-to-side motion as it gathered speed. He and a few others went around the edge, bending and straining to get the now trotting groundlings up and onto the surface.
"Pull your arms and legs in! Don't get in the way of the men pedaling! Too close!"
More stacks of incendiary shot and barrels of the noxious stuff were going up in the warehouses to either side. The wave of heat washed over them. Men covered their faces and held their breaths and pedaled even while they coughed and retched. The heat seared the membranes of their noses and throats, and hoarse screams sounded. Fortunately,
The only way to panic was to pedal harder. Guelph felt dizziness edging his vision with gray, sparks and black spots dancing before his eyes. He drew a cautious breath in, and then another. Hot, but not hot enough to burn his lungs. Around him, men were fainting or breathing cautiously through wet cloths that lay over the train. He could hear the rough jeers and laughter from the ones who'd stayed conscious.
"They'll rib their mates for days," he thought. "It will keep them all alert."
Someone shoved a canteen of improved river water into his hand. He drank, coughed liquid out through his nose, spat and drank again despite the savage pain as the diluted alcohol struck the damaged membranes and passed it along. They pedaled onward into the setting sun, blood-red sunset to the fore, blood-red fire to the rear.
Huan Lu frowned.
So he didn't really do anything bad there?
Not there, Dymbosky said grimly. Your uncle was no coward, and not a bad soldier. It was his bad judgment that gave the enemy their opening. His refusal to let go of hatred and the desire for revenge. We learn the details of that later, from his deeds and his words.
Chapter 3. Dun Juniper to Dun Fairfax. Dutkas of the Clan Mackenzie. Formerly, the East Central Willamette Valley, Oregon. High Kingdom of Montevall. Formerly, Western North America. July 31st. Change year 25. 2023 A.D.
It's by you my place is, Chief, a Dane Aylward Mackenzie said.
Rudy Mackenzie cocked an eyebrow. The commander of his guard regiment continued stolidly, his feet planted apart and hands on his sword belt, his gray eyes steady in his square young face.
I'm bow captain of the High King's archers. You can dismiss me if you've a mind to, but until you do, I'll do my job whether you find it suits your whim or not. Your Majesty.
You never call me that, save when you're going to defy me. Rudy laughed.
With all due respect.
And you never say that unless you're going to be disrespectful either. I have a sufficiency of armed men to guard me here in Dun Juniper, don't you think?
And this.
He slapped a hand at the sword of the lady and went on.
And I'll have you remember I put your face in the midden more than once when we were boys together. I can do it again if I must.
Despite himself, a Dane laughed. At the High King's inquiring glance, he admitted,
"That is most exactly what I said to me little brother Dickie when we got home, word for word, midden and all. And him grown so tall and roinish while we were gone.
Then be off. We'll have our fill of risk this year, and you can throw yourself between it and me. This day I'm going to spend with my mother and stepfather and my sisters in the place I was born. You and your bride, the Sword Maiden, go down to Dun Fairfax and do likewise."
A Dane chuckled as he set foot on the steep path that led down from the plateau of Dun Juniper to Dun Fairfax, where it was tucked away in the valley of Artemis Creek. The quiet of the hillside forest swallowed it, green umber distances between the tall, candle-straight trunks of the Douglas fir and ponderosa pine, red cedar and hemlock, with the odd big-leaf maple or gary oak and black walnut thickly planted long ago for variety. A jay went, "Choink, choink, choink!" Squirrels ran chattering like gray streaks, and a hedgehog scuttled off into the underbrush. Asgard Karlsdottir looked at him and raised one yellow brow. She was only a finger shorter than his 5'9", but with a slender strength in contrast to his broad-shouldered, thick-armed, barrel-chested build. She wore breeks and tunic rather than the kilt, a sax knife and Norheimer broadsword at her belt, but a Mackenzie-style quiver on her back. They both took the steep way effortlessly, ducking and twisting now and then when tree branches or undergrowth nearly caught at the arrows in their quivers,
their feet making little sound despite the boots they wore. Now and then, one would bend a fern gently aside with the tip of the longbows they carried in their left hands, leaving no trace of their passing. Neither was conscious of taking care not to make noise or leave trail. It was a manner you learned when you hunted for food's sake, not to mention scouting and tracking and skirmishing across a continent with life and death for the table stakes.
"What's the gist?"
she asked.
"No gist. Just thinking that I'm a lucky man."
"Lucky in your lord? Or your wife?"
He grinned at her. Freed from the helmet, his oak-colored curls tossed around his tanned face, and she restrained an impulse to smooth them back.
"The both, which is as much luck as a man can decently ask of the powers, eh?"
They both made protective signs, though different ones. He, the invoking pentagram. She, Thor's hammer.
"And I was happy that the sword gave Rudy a happy vision for once. Those children he told us of. It'll be a fine, rare thing to have a little princess and prince about."
Asgard sighed.
"I wish we had such a foretelling," she said.
"Well, as a general rule, folk don't need a vision from a magic sword to produce children, you see. The usual way suffices," he said solemnly.
A glint came into a Dane's gray eye as he deliberately looked her up and down.
"We'll just have to keep practicing over and over until we get it right, so to say."
He dodged as she pretended to clout him along the head with her bow, then said more seriously,
"Though we've plenty of time. We're both of us younger than Rudy and his lady. Why, look at me, ma and da. I come back after only 2 years away and have a new brother and sister tumbling about the place like puppies. Twins, I admit. And born no more than 9 months after I left, almost to a day. But it's scarce decent at their ages. Da'll be 70 come Samhain in a bit."
Asgard snorted.
"Your mother is younger, and that's what counts."
"Aye, 18 year younger, near 19. She lost her first man in the change, my half-sister Tamar's father. He was someplace far away. And Tamar was nobbut a wee one then. Not that I'm not glad to have little Nigel and Nola, of course. The more Aylwards, the better for the clan and the world."
"They do set an example of modesty,"
Asgard said in a pocky tone.
"Modesty is a vice I leave to Christians, as the chief likes to say. But it's odd to think they're younger than Tamar's children, my nieces and nephews. It's taken a good deal out of Ma, too. 50 is old to be brought to bed of a hard labor. And they say it was painful hard. Thank Bridget we have fine midwives and healers."
Asgard shivered a little inwardly. Her people did too. But you went to the mouth of Hela's realm to bring forth life, nonetheless. Then her mouth quirked.
"And she's not all that happy you've brought a foreign wife home, and one who follows other gods than hers."
A Dane shrugged.
"Could be worse, darling. You're not of the old religion, but you're not quite a Cowan either. Now, if you've been a Christian, one of the ones who scorns all other gods and won't so much as set aside a bowl of milk for the house hob, that would have put the manure fork in the soup kettle, right and proper it would."
Asgard wore the triple interlinked triangles of Odin on a thong around her neck. The Valknut. She was Asatru, like most of the folk in her distant homeland of Norheim, what had once been northernmost Maine. Her man went on.
"And she's not over happy her grown children are near all off to the war. Tamar's man Irchu, and me, and Dicky, and even young Fand as an Irgun. Tamar would be too, except that she has a babe at the breast. We'd best remember that there's been war here, with battles and all, while we made our way to Nantucket and back, tricking and twisting and fighting. Not to mention running like buggery when we could, though the bards will leave that out, I'm thinking."
"Only from Norheim to Nantucket and all the way back here for me. But that was long enough. 3,000 miles, is it?"
A chill ran down her back as she remembered what had happened on Nantucket. The details were hazy, as if in a fever dream that slipped away when you woke. But she knew she had stepped out of the light of Midgard's common day there. And the sword. She could hear the seeress's voice, deepened and roughened as the All-Father took hold of her on the high seat of side in the hall at Eriksgarth.
"More potent than Tyrfing, forged for the hand of a king."
They came out of the deep woods, onto a spot where the trail turned downward in a switchback. It had been roughly reinforced with logs and rocks to prevent the soil from washing in the winter rains, and those, in turn, worn by boots and the odd hoof. From here, you were 100 feet above the funnel shape of the little valley, running out into the broader stretches of the Willamette, and could see it all with a sweep of the eyes. A winding strip of forest followed Artemis Creek. The rest of the vale was divided into small fields by neatly trimmed hawthorn hedges studded with lines of poplars and oaks, well grown, but usually no older than a Dane. Some of the fields were the pale brown blonde of reaped wheat, or the gold-shot green of standing barley a month or two from harvest. The vivid grass of cropped pasture lay dreaming beneath the warmth of a sun that brought out the rich smell of earth and sap. White-coated sheep and red cattle grazed there and beneath orchards. Plots of potatoes and vegetables were grouped closer to the walls of the dun. Beaches lined the white surface dirt road that followed the tumbling water, and dust smoked away behind an ox wagon that moved there, small as a child's toy with distance.
"And isn't this a brave, bright sight?"
a Dane said, his voice soft with love.
"I can remember the time my father took me to the spot, after the first harvest, I recall clear, and pointed out our fields and our neighbors, where I'd worked carrying water to the binders, and myself so proud to be part of it. Often and often I thought of this on the journey there and back again."
Asgard tried to see it as he did. Tried and failed.
"Oh, it was beautiful enough," she thought.
Beautiful with an alien comeliness.
"And rich. Richer than Norheim."
Some of the crops were the same. Her folk grew wheat and barley and oats and spuds, too. But here, they planted wheat in the fall and harvested it in the summer, instead of putting seed down in spring and making prayer and blot to Fry and Freya and Thor that the weather held long enough to get it in come fall. Norheimers reaped with one eye on the sky, dreading clouds and cold-driving rain to make the grain sprout and rot in the stack. Hail that could beat it flat, and even early snow. Here, it was one fine warm day after another for the ripening. So, in the Mackenzie Dutkas, barley went mostly to beer, and oats to horses, and they didn't bother with rye. Everyone ate fine, feast-time white bread made from wheat flour every day if they pleased, like a great chief. There were fruits here she'd only heard about in tales. Apricots and cherries, pears and peaches and nectarines, even grapes for wine. You could graze stock outside 10 or 11 months of the year, too. She'd never seen such a wealth of strong, fat beasts. Winters here were chilly and wet, not the endless, gray, iron cold and driving blizzards she'd grown up with. And there were near 100 days more between the last killing frost and the first.
"Rich land, well farmed, and plenty of it," she thought. "The only wealth that's really real. Never a hungry spring for my children when they come. A place for them to grow straight and strong and carry our blood down the years and our children's children."
But for a moment she was possessed by a bitter longing for the hard pine scent of the homeland winds, the pale light of the short midsummer nights gleaming on the silver bark of the birches, and even the bright chill of a winter morning when the land seemed crusted with diamond and the air crackled in your nose. There was no point in talking of any of that. She had made her decision, for reasons which still seemed good, and she would abide what came of it. A Dane, best of all. And where he was, she would make her home.
"The harvest was fine,"
she said instead. The surefire conversational gambit. She couldn't imagine anyone not being interested in that.
"The heads and the sheaves were thick and heavy.
50 bushels an acre if it's one. Despite pushing it just a wee bit early for the war's sake and letting the grain dry in the stocks,"
a Dane agreed.
"Nor any sign of the rust. As good as I can remember since the change."
He cocked an eye at her.
"And you pitched in very well, with not a word said. Everyone was pleased, and more than one told me so."
Asgard flushed, happy and a little angry at the same time that anyone could have doubted her. She'd seen lands where a few rich lorded over all the others and despised toil and sweat, but she was glad that among Mackenzies everyone worked and fought when needful. Back in Norheim, she'd often seen King Bjarni with his hands on the handles of a plow or the haft of an axe, and Queen Harberga busy with loom and churn, or helping get in the hay.
"Who but anything would do otherwise," she said. "When there's real work to be done, you do it with all you have. The whites give no luck to the lazy, nor would Fry and Freya if I lacked respect for their gifts."
A Dane chuckled.
"I know your Kushla, and have for a year now, and I know your folk a little. So I know why your back's up and bristling like an angry cat. There's no harm making a good impression on those who don't know you or them, though, eh? We Mackenzies think well of a hard worker, too. And you're the new wolf in the pack here."
She nodded.
"I haven't met many Norheimer men who are as good as following a woman's thoughts," she mused. "He's a troll-killing terror in a fight, my Dane, and a stallion in the blankets. And he can hunt anything that flies or runs. But in some ways, he's as sensitive as another girl."
The thought gave her a flush of pleasure. She hid it by cocking her head to one side and considering Dun Fairfax itself, seen as a bird or a god might view it, and away from the confusing, thronging closeness that had blurred her vision of it before. There was nothing quite like a Dun of Clan Mackenzie in Norheim. The thorpe of a Godi, the home place of a ring-giving Dryton chief, would come closest. But that would be dominated by the hall, and none held quite so many dwellers. Most Norheimers lived each family of Yeoman Bondar by itself in the center of its allodial family land, the way her own parents and siblings did, with perhaps a few dependents' homes to make a hamlet for the most prosperous. Dun Fairfax was a rectangle surrounded by a palisade of logs set in concrete and bound together with steel cable. There were blockhouses at the corners and flanking the gate, made from squared balks of timber. The whole was built from big logs, as thick as her body and many man lengths high, for the trees grew tall and great here. They'd been stripped of bark, too, and varnished and oiled and polished, and bands across them had been carved with low relief patterns of twining leaves and vines and serpents and elongated beasts, colorfully painted and inlaid with glass and stone, from which whimsical faces peered, human and demi-human, bestial and divine. Mackenzies were fond of that effect, but it always made her feel as if something was looking at her, just out of sight at the corners of her eyes. Here, you always felt that the other world was only a half step away. A clear space of close-cropped pasture was kept outside the walls. Within were the homes and workshops along cobbled lanes. The tall, steep-pitched covenstead that served for ceremony and gatherings and school for the children, and a communal barn and grain elevator and warehouse where things like the reaping machines were kept. There was a pond like the Blue Eye near the center, where ducks and geese swam, surrounded by willows and oaks and a stretch of grass. Smoke drifted blue from brick chimneys in roofs that might be mossy shingle or flower-starred green turf, and very faintly she could hear the tink-tank-clang of a smith at work. The largest house was a pre-change frame structure, not at all unlike some she'd seen as a girl. But it was much altered and painted in a pale blue. The corners and windows and door lintels had all been set with bands of carved planking, picked out in gold, yellow, and scarlet and green.
Beautiful, but different. Very strange. Witchy, she thought.
Too crowded, she said aloud. And then again had that disconcerting feeling that Adane was following her real thoughts.
All those households within one wall.
Ah, well, it was bad in Norheim after the change. But worse for us, he said blandly. For 10 years, war hung over us like a thundercloud of threats and raids before it burst. I remember the wars against the Association, though I was not but a nipper when Rudy was taken prisoner, and the Northerners besieged Sutterdown. And I recall Dahl leading our archers out to the field of gold. And bad bandit troubles before and after and during that. Gangs of the Spalpeens. So it wasn't safe for families to live apart on their own as your folk do. We got into the habit of dwelling close, so.
It's still as packed with folk as an egg is with meat, she grumbled.
Forby it's a bit crowded now, yes. What with the Easterners we've given refuge, and our own numbers growing. Perhaps after the war we'll get together with Dun Carson and some others and found a new settlement. Unspoken went,
if too many don't die in the battles to come.
There was quiet pride in his voice. We've done it before, and more than twice. This is the oldest Dun in the clan's territory, after Dun Juniper. And Dun Juniper's different. This was the first of our farming duns, and the pattern for the others so. The bigger house was the Aylward household, where her man's family dwelt. Her marriage kin now. She took a deep breath. No task grew easier, and no danger grew less because you flinched from it. Just as she did, they both heard soft, quiet steps coming from below. Hands went to weapons, and Adane made a sound between his teeth, the buzzing trill of some local bird she didn't know. The like answered it, and they relaxed. Then a man and 3 dogs came into sight. Dicky, Adane said, slipping the arrow back into his quiver. His younger brother was just 18, and hence a little younger than Asgard herself. In a kilt, but barefoot, with only a sleeveless shirt below his quiver, and a bow in his hand, and a dirk at his belt. He had a kin look of a Dane, but his long queue of hair was a brown ruddy with a tint of old rust, his face half covered with freckles where it wasn't pale, and his build more lanky.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.